we doing? Everybody okay? Good. It's good to see you this morning as we gather together to worship in this first Sunday of Advent, as we get excited for all this Christmas story brings. Before I run through the week, I'm going to pass over to Mike.
Morning. Some of you might notice something a bit different about me this week. So a friend of mine last week had surgery to operate on a brain tumour, which was successful for what it was. There's still plenty of way to go. So I shaved my head yesterday to support him and raising money for Brains Trust. I'm so far, I think we've raised £630, but I've got a bit of a way to go to the target of £750, which is what I've set at the moment. So if anybody would like to sponsor me, there is a link on the Facebook members group, or come and chat to me and I can let you know. But thank you all for your support so far. It's been amazing. So thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so looking to the week ahead, as through all of December, opportunities to get involved and assist with practical things. This week, tomorrow, there are a load of boxes in my shed that need to come here ahead of the food parcels. If anybody is available to help remove boxes from my house and bring them here, that's at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. That would be great, thank you. Then on Tuesday we have food delivery here from Booker's. We have three lorries coming. I believe 16 pallets of food will enter this building. And then throughout Tuesday and Wednesday, the sorting of food for the food boxes. Again, there are lists at the back for all of these things if you'd like to get involved or can get involved, have a sign up on there. Next Sunday morning will be our toy service ahead of our Rotary concert in the evening. Plenty of tickets left for Rotary concert. Again, I think they are available on the information point at the back. So spread the word amongst your friends. That is all for now. Thank you. Captain James.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
How are we at waiting? Do we enjoy waiting for things to arrive in the post? Do we enjoy waiting for events to happen? I don't know, I'm guessing most of us at some point get quite impatient, certainly when things don't run as quickly as what we expect. But we're in this time of waiting, this time of Advent. It's about the future, our future. Yes, but more importantly, God's future, as the Jews waited for centuries for God to release them from bondage. We wait for the full realisation of the kingdom that is Jesus, launched almost 2,000 years ago. James chapter 5 verse 7 says, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming." We're supposed to spend the rest of our lives waiting here on earth. Well, yes. We probably will be eager in anticipation and with plenty to do. So that means in the waiting, we don't just sit and wait, but actually we do life. It's in the waiting because we will be with God himself, who brings his kingdom and its fulfillment, not us. It is active because we do not sit around passively waiting for God to take care of everything in the world that needs fixing, but we join in that God is calling us to do. So we're going to start by singing the song 39. It says, "Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, God of love. Hearts unfurled like flowers before thee, hail thee as the sun above." Let's stand and we'll sing these verses through. Thank you. I suppose in our waiting, it depends what we're waiting for, isn't it? Often on a Sunday, in the week, I drop things into a Dropbox, which should appear on the laptop here on a Sunday. And they turn the laptop on and they're not always there. We have to wait for the things to arrive. And have they arrived today? Good, thank you. And sometimes it just sets a little bit on edge, doesn't it? When we're expecting something to be there and it's not, and we have to wait for the stuff to arrive. And yeah, just keeps my heart beating on a Sunday morning. But as we come to worship, we come because Jesus is the light of the world. And we come to worship the light of the world, don't we? We're going to turn to Psalm 114. It simply says, "Light of the world, you stepped down into the darkness, opened my eyes. Let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you." In that sense of waiting, we don't wait alone, but we wait with the light of the world. And our response can be, "So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me." Let's sing. Thank you. So as part of our Advent worship, each week we're going to light the Advent candles, and different people are going to lead us through that. And this morning, Andrew and Holly are going to come lead us. Thank you.
Mary bore a child like no other mother has ever born. She bore a new creation. The language the angel used for the formation of Jesus in Mary's womb is the language of creation, not conception.
The Holy Spirit will come over you, and the power of the Most High. height will overshadow you.
As perplexed as she was, she didn't dismiss the message. She sought understanding, and Gabriel told her the miracle by which it would happen. When he finished explaining, Mary said to him,
I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me just as you have said.
The question for all of us is, do we have such a Mary in us when we hear an overwhelming word from the Lord? Do we say,
let it be with me just as you have said?
This Advent and Christmas season, perhaps you will hear a voice or see a vision inviting you towards a calling or a task beyond what you envisioned for yourself or thought possible. Will you hear and see with a Mary-like courage? And will you act with a Mary-like faith?
Shall we pray? Loving God, who chose Mary, a humble servant, to bring your love into the world, we offer you our sense of unworthiness. Use us to carry Christ's presence wherever we go. When in doubt, when we doubt your purpose for us or hesitate to answer your call, remind us that in your hands, even our weakness can become a vessel of grace. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who knows us fully and loves us completely. Amen.
It's easy for us, isn't it, as we look at Scripture, those parts of Scripture that are well known to us, and particularly as we enter into Christmas, for us just to, we know the story, don't we? Yeah. But actually, the impact that can have for us, and as we were reminded, what is God going to say to us this Advent season? But not only that, how will we respond? Will we respond as Mary calmly? And just say, yes, Lord, that's, let's sit and wait and let it evolve. Or maybe some of us are a little bit more active in our waiting, thinking, Christ, you come to us, each of us, but actually we need to, recognise that actually he comes to us on a daily basis and how we share that with each other. We're going to listen to the songs who are going to bring to us, come into our world. And as we, in our waiting, we pray that God will continue to evolve and come into our world, that we will see God in our everyday. Thank you.
Thank you.
May Christ come into each of our lives today and as we journey through this time of waiting. There's going to be some responsive readings come on the screen just now. And I'll read the leader part if you can respond with the all. We've been given some explicit instructions on how to wait as followers of Jesus. The entire New Testament is all about how we wait actively. We start now, by the grace of God, to live by the law of love that comes to the kingdom of God. Jesus gave us. Jesus commands of God. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." Jesus commanded, "Love your neighbor." Love your neighbors as yourself. The law and the prophets hang on these two commands. Jesus commands, "Love your fellow Christians." A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Jesus commanded, "Love your enemies." You have heard what it was said, "Love your neighbor and hate your enemies." But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you will be children of your Father in heaven. He caused the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends the rain to the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? You are not even the tax collector doing that. And if you greet only your own people, then what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Our hands are not tied behind our backs. Our hearts are not blocked. Jesus releases us to live God's future in the now as we express our love to all those we come to meet, those of which we live alongside, those of which we worship alongside, and those who at times may cause us upset or concern. We're called to love one another. This expression of love that we see at Christmas, love in the form of a baby Jesus, expressed by God the Father for each of us, for all of us, however we find ourselves today. So let us pray this morning as we come before the God of love, the God who calls us into relationship with him, into an active time of waiting. Let's pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we come before you just now. We give you thanks for today. Thanks for the gift of today, the present. Oh, we sang that you are the light of the world. You are the King of all kings. Father, thank you that you are in each of our lives. Whether we choose to recognize it or whether we always see it, but thank you, Father, even at those times when we struggle to see where you're at work, that you continue to be at work. And you call us to be actively waiting. Waiting for the coming of Jesus. Not just to sit around and wait, but to join in what you're doing. To be your hands and feet within this community. In those places where we do life. Father, we thank you for the opportunities that we will have this week to serve our community. To work with others. To partner with others in the mission of God. Thank you for those who have given in order that we can share quite material, basic things, but yet expression of your love to them. And Lord, as our musical groups go out and about the area over the next couple of weeks, again, in the sense of active waiting, we just pray for them and the places that they'll be, that they'll share the love and the hope of which we celebrate here, and the joy and that we celebrate within this season. So Father, help us to be your hands and feet, we pray. Amen. We're going to, the young people are going to come and sing, and Andrew, share with us what you're doing.
So yeah, the children are going to bring a song, a simple chorus, which is based exactly on that Bible reading from Luke, and it's called Love the Lord Your God.
Reminder of those words that are in the Old Testament and in the New Testament that are called to love the Lord our God with all of our being, and all of our strength. I wonder, what's the longest you've ever had to wait for something? What's the longest you've ever kind of, whether something has been sat in front of you, like a gift that might have happened like on Christmas Day, you've been sat there and you've looked at it, okay? Share with the person next to you, kind of, what's the longest thing that you've had to wait for? Okay, so are people, how do people feel about waiting? I mean, it depends, doesn't it? We were just chatting about, like, when somebody asks you what you would want for your Christmas or birthday gift, and you've made some suggestions, and they've kind of suggested which one they're going to buy, and so you know you're getting something, but like you've suggested maybe weeks or months in advance, and then you have to wait for that particular day for it to arrive, and then hopefully you receive what you asked for. That kind of thing. But that's the kind of season that we're in, isn't it? In the sense of, as we continue to wait, whilst we know that we will celebrate the birth of Jesus on the 25th of December, actually, as we actively wait, we could choose to just sit back for the next 24 days. Now, for some of us in the room who are organised and everything's wrapped and bought and in the freezer or whatever, that'll be okay. And for others of us who probably have not quite so organised that far in advance, we'll be like, maybe not. But in this active time, it's not wasted, is it? Because as we prepare, we are thinking about those of which we are buying gifts for, those that we will share with, and but also in this time as Christians, as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Jesus, and the fact that his light will shine around us. So let's listen to the band this morning. Thank you. People go out for a second. Charles, I'll just don't go any further. Thank you. You don't make a step there. Be worth just to recognise, last week, cake was provided by Charles to celebrate her graduation, of which we give you great thanks, but also well done. So we'll give you a round of applause. Thank you. You can go to Sunday school now, that's fine. You can, yeah. I mean, kind of degrees and stuff must be, they're a challenge in the first place, but when it's in your second or third language, of which Shahzad has done, that's an even added dimension to that. Yeah. We're going to sing a song that's not found in the songbook, but speaks about this strength as we wait upon the Lord, and we're not left in our waiting. God strengthens us and comes with us. The strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord. And talks about our God is an everlasting God who is with us throughout. So shall we stand and we'll sing this song. Thank you.
This morning is taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning at verse 39. These verses follow on from the ones quoted by Holly and Isabel earlier on. In the Core Bible, it's page number 1026. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is this child you will bear. Why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home.
Thank you, John. So, happy first Sunday in Advent. Does it feel like Christmas yet? No. We were having this conversation in the office this week. Like, you know, much is happening in regards to organising Christmas, but it doesn't particularly feel Christmas yet. And maybe as the days go on, it'll feel more and more like that. But we're in the kind of like, I mean, for some of the shops of which we may have frequented in the last couple of months, Christmas has been there since September. Yeah, never want to miss a trick. But there we are. That's kind of where we sit, isn't it? But as we enter into kind of our official Christmas season, we might come to worship today with a combination of feelings. Some of us might be so excited that for all the Christmas celebrations that are going to kick off from today, and we kind of ran to church this morning because we just love the Advent season. Others may come slightly more weary and a little bit, we'll deal with Christmas when we get to it later in the month. We don't want to call out people Grinches or kind of bah humbugs, but you know, for all kinds of reasons, people respond to this season in different ways. Now, there may be those of you who do Elf on the Shelf in your house, who start off very eagerly in the beginning of December, and then by the time you get later on into the month, you think, why did we start this? As each day you get an elf and you kind of set up a scene for your children to find in the morning, or whoever you're doing it for. It could be adults in your household as well. But yeah, as we kind of come into this time of preparation, well, I want you to invite you over these next couple of weeks to join with me as we each Sunday kind of look at what it means to be living Christmas. There's really no point in the lights and the decorations and the presents if we are not living out the good news of Jesus. That Christmas is all about. And we should want people who are living the living Christmas to know about Christ. Our lives, regardless of the season, should reflect the story of the goodness and the grace that Jesus is coming into our world. Advent is a Latin word which means coming or coming into. It's the beginning of the Christmas calendar. It celebrates two things. First, the arrival into our world as a baby Jesus, and secondly, in preparation for Jesus' return. In this season of Advent, we are reminded about the past and the anticipation of the future. While we remember, we anticipate. We are living our lives as we wait. I don't know. Advent season tends to be quite a bit more busy, doesn't it, than maybe some other months. And in the sense of making sure that we are living out the living Christmas. For 400 years, people of Israel were waiting to hear from God. 400 years of silence. So you may have thought that waiting for your Christmas gift or whatever it is for a few weeks was a long time. Try 400 years. It might have felt like 400 years for you, but the Israelites were waiting 400 years. They were waiting to hear from God. But more than that, they were waiting for the Messiah, a saviour, a leader to reconcile them to God. 400 years of waiting between them, between what's recorded in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And now we've been waiting more than 2,000 years since Jesus' death for his second coming. While it might not feel like it, God created us to be people who can wait. We are reminded in James chapter 5, verses 7 and 8. Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's second coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield his valuable crop, waiting patiently for the autumn and the spring and the rains. You too, be patient, stand firm, because the Lord's coming near. So what kind of a waiter are you? What's your waiting personality? When you've placed your order for your parcel to come through the post, are you there counting down the days? Although the reality is most things we can get next day delivery. So, yeah. But are we a nervous waiter? Do we sit there and we twiddle our thumbs? And, you know, when you're sat in the waiting room of the doctors, the dentist, or anything else that we might not necessarily look forward to, do we sit there twiddling our thumbs thinking, watching the clock? All right, come on. Okay, they were here before me, so they've gone in. So where am I in the queue? Trying to work it out. Are we a fast-paced waiter, you know, waiting for that things would just kind of move on quickly? Are we a busy waiter? Do we fill our time with lots of things to do so we don't recognise the time that necessarily we need to be waiting? Actually, we're not sat in that kind of position of waiting. Are we a critical waiter where we kind of see the flaws in everything and we kind of like think forward, think all the things that could go wrong in that kind of our waiting? Oh, well, you see, if this doesn't happen, then this might happen and that won't happen and all that kind of thing. Are we a worried waiter as we sit there? Not only we just kind of think of, ooh, we're overwhelmed that things are just taking too long. I'm sure we've all been there. And what are the implications of that? Now, the reality is, I'm sure we can all fit ourselves into each of those categories, depending on what we're waiting for. And I don't think we are one or the other, but actually, A, depending on what we're waiting for, but also how we're feeling generally around will affect our type and our attitude towards waiting. But today we are considering what it means to live Christmas this Advent season, and I want us to consider being Christians who are committed into the active waiting. What does it look like? Let's look to Mary. I think one of the most familiar stories we read at this time. Mary was engaged to be married, and an angel came to tell her that she was going to conceive through the Holy Spirit, who would be this, and their child would be the saviour of the world. I think all of us can agree, kind of, that's pretty shocking and just life-changing news. And while most teenage girls would probably freak out, Mary's response is, well, it's perfect. In verse 38, we read that Mary says, I am the Lord's servant. May your word be fulfilled. This is obedience. This is what obedience looks like. Shocking news is shared, and her response is, let it be so. Do you know what happened next? Well, not much. There's lots of waiting involved. We know that she waited at least a few days to go and visit her cousin, Elizabeth. And the truth is that preparing and anticipating for a baby to arrive involves a lot of waiting. And in the waiting, Mary was obedient. So active waiting means to be obedient. Mary was essentially recruited into the most important pregnancy on earth, the supernatural incarnation in her womb. And she just said, yes, Lord, if it be so, may your words be fulfilled in me. So if we turn to, if we look at Matthew chapter 22, and these are verses we've kind of already looked at this morning. Our young people sung them, and we've looked at them before. Matthew chapter 22, 37 to 39. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And the first and greatest commandment, and the second is to love your neighbour as yourself." As we look, as we wait, we don't do that in isolation, but we do that with others around, both with God, but also with those of which we live and amongst. The second thing is that we act in active waiting means to choose love. While we are waiting for Jesus to return, we don't just be cranky and critical and worry and busy ourselves and be nervous waiters. We want to be people who are actively loving God and actively loving others each day. And as we look at these verses in Matthew, we're reminded that we are called as Christians to love God and to love others. In some verses in chapter 5, 44 and 48 of Matthew's Gospel, it reminds us even about loving our enemies, people maybe that we don't naturally get on with, maybe we've had cross words with. So that's not always that straightforward and easy, is it? But that's what living Christmas is like, looks like for us. Christmas living is not passive. Loving God, loving people is our mission and our aim and is fueled by the Holy Spirit. While we are waiting, we are loving. Even when it is difficult, even when it requires sacrifice, even when it requires putting others first. So instead of me asking the question of how do you wait, let us give ourselves a challenge of how will you wait. My prayer is that you will choose to be active waiting for Jesus with obedience to his love. There is a beauty in the active waiting. God, in his beautiful design, gave us three things to help us wait. While we are actively waiting, we can depend on the Holy Spirit. We are not alone. God is with us. Jesus says that gives us the promise of the gift of the Holy Spirit. We have our church family, the body of Christ. As dysfunctional as it may be, or as functional as it may be, actually, we are still called to support one another, and it's a gift as we experience life together. Choosing to be obedient in love and to love each other. 1 Corinthians 12 talks about that we're all part of one body and to love one another. A lot of our time in worship we share in music and song. And Mary responds to, it's often described as Mary's song, kind of a song back to the Lord, a song of praise. Mary was overwhelmed, but inspired that her response was kind of with poetry. Music and lyrics are a gift from God in our waiting. That's why we sing on a Sunday. It's why we encourage people to use and develop their musical gifts as part of to God's glory. While we are waiting, we have music. We have each other. We have the presence of God within us and around us. So this morning, how will you wait? Maybe Jesus isn't the Lord of your lives today. Well, today we can make that the case. Today's the day you've been waiting for. To change your waiting from dread and confusion to hope and peace. How will we wait? Through holy living. Are we choosing to be obedient while we are actively waiting? Are we choosing to love God and to love others in our active waiting? Are we choosing to wait where we depend upon God more and more in our waiting? You know, it's easy, isn't it, when we know something's going to happen, to say that we'll wait for it. And when we've got a clear, defined time. The reality is that we can order our parcels online and we can select a date, and 9 times out of 10, it arrives at the time slot it's arranged. And when it doesn't come, we then probably get a little bit agitated, don't we? But yet, by the power of the Holy Spirit and the body of Christ, the church here, the core here, may we wait patiently, depend upon God, depend upon one another, and may we give our praise to God. We're going to turn to a little chorus that says, "We bow down and confess you are Lord in this place. We bow down and confess you are all. So you are Lord in this place. You are all I need. It's your face I seek in the presence of your light. We bow down. We bow down." In the sense of, in this time of waiting, we come and we bow before the King of Kings. In the presence of the Holy Spirit, let us come and let's bow down. Thank you. Father, we do indeed bow down. We confess our need of you. As in that second verse, you are all we need. And it's in your presence that we feel whole. And it's in your presence that we sit and we wait. But also we move forward in your presence too, Lord. Lord, I just pray that whatever season that we're in at the moment, whatever we're, for those of us who are waiting for those things of life, that yeah, we may be nervous about what is around the corner. We may wish things would go quicker, answers would come. But Lord, I just pray your peace upon us all. that in the waiting we will know your presence. We will know your supportive Holy Spirit. And Lord, and when our humanness wants to take over, Lord, may our response be that of Mary, that may it be so, Lord. May your will be done. So, Father, in this Advent season, as we anticipate the arrival of the celebration of Jesus later this month, as we gear towards that, may, yes, all the practical things that maybe we need to do be done, but let us not be focused so much on the practical, but actually we continue to live Christmas each day. We live the birth of Jesus, the Emmanuel, God with us, and we share that with those of which we do life with. Lord, may Christmas come alive for us again this year. And Lord, as Christians, as we wait in anticipation for the second coming of Jesus, Lord, let us be mindful of that, but not so focused on that that we don't recognise the present. Lord, may we be your hands and feet to love God and to love others. Lord, we pray that as many of us will be involved in many things in these next few weeks, whether that be in the community support program in the parcels, whether that be in the visiting of many different community groups with our musical groups, may we indeed express something of the living Christmas, the God who loves us and loves them, that people be brought back to God. Father, please take our worship today and bless each of us, we pray, as we go into this week. And Lord, may you continue to reveal yourself to us each and every day. Amen. We're going to turn in closing to Song 104 that says, "Come thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us, let us find our rest in thee." Let us stand and we'll sing these verses through. And we might not have to wait 400 years for our thing, but let us wait joyfully and tell others of Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you.
benediction. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen.